to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing. I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing.
Come on, you say.
Everything I give to you, oh God.
It's significant. And it's something that we should never forget. I was waiting, amen, Sister Alma was back, she's gone back in the back. I was waiting for her to get up. I said, wait a minute, when the announcement clerk was announcing birthdays for the month, and they called her up and they said, the 25th coming this week. And we acknowledge everybody's birthday all year long. Oh, I'm talking now. I'm preaching. And we sing about Jesus, but we didn't tell him happy birthday. Somebody say something. Just that little bit, we can get so caught off track that we can get sidetracked. About Jesus. This morning I want you to know Jesus is the reason for the season. The book of Isaiah is one of the books that we're going to use, the 7th chapter, verse number 14. You have a pencil, write this one down as well. Matthew's 1st chapter, 18 through 23. Just got two more. Just one. I don't know if we get to Micah in the Old Testament, the 5th chapter, verse number 2. And then Luke, we'll stop there. Luke, the 2nd chapter, verse 1 through 7. Luke, the 2nd chapter, verse 1 through 7. We can time, go back and you can read this one. Micah, 5th chapter, verse number 2. Matthew's the 1st chapter, verse 18 through 23. Just make it thing for your mic. And then Isaiah, the 7th chapter, verse number 14. I want to talk about the birth, Jesus' birth. It was a timely event. And when you go home and you read these chapters, I want you to be able to put like a puzzle together. And it will give you a picture of Jesus. It will give you prophetically what Jesus said, what the prophets talked about, and how the prophets prophesied that Jesus was going to be born. It's amazing to me how with Google and all of these other devices and things that we have, that how we can sort of find almost anything out. But yet we have the Bible that you can go into and you can read these particular chapters, and if you do some studying, you can see, wow, the prophet said this was going to happen. And this prophecy took 700 years to take place, 700 years before it manifested itself. In other words, the prophet stood up and said this was going to happen. And then 700 years later, it took place. I want to talk about it this morning. Isaiah, let's start with Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah. 7th chapter, verse number 14.
Isaiah 7th chapter, verse 14.
Yes.
Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign.
Therefore, this is Isaiah. This is somebody called some individuals call him the eagle-eyed prophet because he saw way down the road Isaiah see he's talking, saying, and letting them know that that the Lord himself is going to give you a sign. Okay, you know, those that were in Sunday school this morning, we read about that. The shepherds that were there watching their flock, and the angels came and talked to the shepherds and told them about it going to be a sign. Okay, and come on, read.
Behold.
Listen now. For those that's not familiar with the Bible, this is in the Old Testament.
Come on, man.
Isaiah, in this seventh chapter, is in the Old Testament. 700 years before it took place, saying it's going to be a sign. And this is going to be the sign. He said, behold, just look, come on.
The virgin shall conceive and bear a son.
Yes.
And shall call his name Emmanuel.
Here, Isaiah is clearly giving us a prophecy. And to be honest with you, I'm glad I'm not Isaiah, because it didn't take place until 700 years later. I'm glad I'm not Isaiah. Because you know, and I know, everybody would call him a liar. Because Isaiah died and never saw the promise manifest itself. But the prophecy stayed out there.
That's right.
He said that a virgin was going to conceive and bear a son. And he should call his name Emmanuel. That's a whole lot. I could stop right there and preach all day. But you know what I know, there's no such thing, no such monster as a virgin having a child.
Amen.
So it's got to be a miracle. And then when he used the term, his name is going to be Emmanuel, this miracle is going to represent God with us.
Yes.
Come on, read. Let's take us into Matthew's. Let's see what Matthew's saying.
Matthew is the first chapter?
The first chapter. Starting
in the 18th verse.
Starting 18.
Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit.
Now, they use this word betrothed, and I just, you know, want to do a little background on it, just a little bit, not too much, because I really don't want to take myself away from where I want to go with this message. But in biblical days, when an individual say that they're going to marry somebody, we would call that being engaged. Okay? And say, you know, will you marry me? And they're engaged. Whatever that period is.
Yeah.
That was almost like they were already married. Hello.
Amen.
Everything except for consummation of marriage.
Amen.
That means they have never did anything as husband and wife, sexually.
Yeah.
Somebody help me in this place.
Yeah.
Now I got this adult looking at me like, what are you talking about? Punch your names and name them. They didn't do anything. You don't understand that shit. We find that Joseph was a man that was willing not to mess his wife up, not to throw her away, but privately give her a bill of divorce. Because Joseph made it clear that he didn't have anything to do with her.
Right.
And that sounds like the men today, hey, my baby. I had nothing to do with it. Come on, y'all, help me in this way. But today, if Mary had said that was Joseph's baby, they could have tested him and taken
it. DNA.
So he had to be born when he did. Cause DNA is here now.
Right.
But we see that Mary was found with child, and she was pregnant by the Holy Ghost. Now, I don't want to bore you, and I don't want to mess with your mind. But it's hard to believe that the Holy Ghost can impregnate somebody. But if you've been saved for a while, and God really speaks to you, God can get in your spirit and see like you can impregnate it. Somebody help me here. Something can get in you and it began to start taking over and start growing in you. That's what vision is. You can be impregnated with vision. Okay. Next year we're going into a new direction. Amen. You know, some of us don't feel that we're bound for destiny, but we are bound for destiny. Your destiny could be up, your destiny could be down. But you will be bound, amen, next year into destiny, into a new direction. And you have to make a decision what direction you're going to travel in. God's not going to give it to me to tell you where you need to travel. People speak to you. And when God speaks to you and give you direction on where you should be traveling and what you should be doing, that is going to birth in you and you're going to feel like you're impregnated. Began to look at this. Read verse 18, 19.
And her husband Joseph.
This is Joseph.
Being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame. Resolved to divorce her quietly.
See, Job was ready to divorce Mary quietly. You say you're pregnant, I believe it, but it's not my child. I'm not gonna make a big scandal of it. I'm gonna just put you away pride. Now, in that day and time, they would stone Mary to death.
That's right.
They would take Mary outside the city,
that's right.
Pick up the rocks,
stone
her. And throw it at her and hit her until she died. But Job said, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to divorce you privately. I'm going to give you a bill of divorce privately and put you away. Come on, read.
But as he considered these things,
as Joseph thought about those things,
behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph,
look, Joseph,
son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife.
Come on.
For that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
Okay, so Joseph, as he thought about those things, you know, when you think about things, you're going to find yourself dreaming about it. It's important. Try this. Go home, listen to some spiritual music all night long. You'll wake up okay.
Amen.
A week later, watch a horror movie. You'll jump all night long. Somebody help me in this place. You see, it'll get in you. So that thing began to start troubling Joseph because he was battling in his mind, that's not my child. I'm put away privately. But I need to do this. And I need to do it so that she don't get stoned. But I just don't believe that. I don't know what happened. Because Mary, to start off with, was a clean, pure virgin. She never knew a man. Somebody help me here. Because the scripture got to manifest itself.
Right.
A virgin shall conceive. Isaiah. Somebody help me here. So Mary had to be a virgin in order for Christ to be born through. And she had to be pure. Somebody help me here. You got virgin oil, but it's got something else in it. And you got pure virgin oil. I wish I had one out of it yet. I don't went somewhere. I don't went there now. I don't said something. Y'all look at me like, what you mean? You know, how can you be a virgin and not be pure? Well, some people make themselves a virgin after they stop that. I can tell you about Anna in the temple. Keep on reading. You'll find it. She made herself stay in the temple. How can y'all read? Come on, read.
Verse 21. She will bear a son.
This is what the virgin is going to do, that have this child that's conceived by the Holy Spirit. She's going to bear a son.
And you shall call his name Jesus.
Now, sometimes we look at the scripture and one would say Emmanuel. And at this time we see that in Matthew, and he told Mary to call Emmanuel Jesus. And some people look at that as a conflict. Brother Onwood, I got a resolution for that. I do. I really do. It took God to save us.
That's right.
That's why you had Emmanuel, God, with us. But God, as God in the Spirit, as the Father, cannot die. I wish I had somebody in here. Had to have somebody in flesh to die. So God left heaven and got inside Mary and stopped being God, but he was still God, and started being Jesus. I wish I had somebody that can just take with it for me. Because John picked it up and said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Come on, going around and talking about that Word and how it said that that Word became flesh and manifested itself and dwelt among us.
Amen.
So they talked about Jesus, how God came down through Mary and became flesh.
Yeah.
And so that's why I said, and his name shall, in Matthew said, and his name shall be called Jesus. Why? For he shall save his people from their sins. We have the Savior of the world.
Amen.
Being born.
Yes.
Through Mary. Come on, read.
All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has spoken by the prophet.
Okay, so we see that 700 years later, y'all go do the math, do it later, you know, do it, just check Isaiah out, then check Matthew out, and you will see 700 years took place. 7 is God's perfect number.
Amen.
Here's the number of completion. Come on, read.
Verse 23. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel.
And you see Emmanuel.
Which
go ahead.
Which means God with us.
Now, I said all that, but it seems like the angel told in Matthew that the child's name is going to be Jesus and it's going to be Emmanuel. Now, you know, and I know, that when he grew up, nobody called him Emmanuel. Nobody, you don't go to the text and find out that they called and Emmanuel was on the cross. And Emmanuel was baptized by John the Baptist. Behold, the Lamb of God. The take away, he said, God is coming, the Lamb of God, the sacrifice is coming. But they didn't call him Emmanuel. Because deliverance wasn't in Emmanuel. Deliverance came through Jesus. Somebody help me. Salvation comes through Jesus. I just want you to understand that Jesus is the reason for the season. Micah is a little small book in the Old Testament. Most of us that are in here probably have not even read that unless they heard another preacher preach or teach about it. Book of Micah. That's a good book to read.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, the Book of Micah talked about the children of Israel, and talked about how their lifestyle was so messy. This particular book, if you go back and you read, I picked up the fifth chapter, but if you read the third chapter, somewhere around in that chapter, you're gonna see around in that these people were calling right wrong
off the hook
and wrong right.
Amen.
Our society today have made a decision called wrong right and right wrong. And we don't have to go through what's right and what's wrong, but it's a deliberate attempt to get us off course.
Amen.
A deliberate attempt.
Deliberate.
Yeah.
Somebody say something to me.
That's right.
And if we're not careful, we'll follow that trend. And we will accept and embrace wrong.
That's right.
No matter what it is. Look at your neighbor. It don't matter what it is. I hear you say it don't care. I hear you say something wrong. It don't care. It does care. It doesn't matter what it is. If God say that it's wrong,
then it's wrong.
It doesn't matter what the legislation say.
That's right.
The judges, the congressmen, the senators, the president, it doesn't matter what the preachers, somebody say preachers.
Go ahead.
The preachers can say something different. It don't matter. If God says that is wrong, it is wrong. The Bible tells me, I saw this young when I was young. He said, let God be true and every man alive. Right. And look at Mike, this little book, and it's a little powerful book. It didn't make sense for a minute, but verse number 2, chapter 5, verse number 2. Read.
Yes. But you, Bethlehem, Ephrathah.
Do it again.
But you, O Bethlehem, Ephrathah.
How you say that word?
Ephrathah.
How you say it?
Ephrathah.
Ephrathah. So you're speaking in tongues. Ephrathah.
Who are too little to be among the clans of your coming forth as from of old, from ancient days. Therefore.
That's verse 2.
Read that,
Rabbi. Read that from KJV.
But thou, Bethlehem, Ephrathah,
yes.
Though thou be little among the thousands of Judah.
You be little. Listen, he was saying, the prophet Micah was saying, Bethlehem is little among Israel. It's like an outskirt town. It's like it's a spot on the side. It's not big. It's not a grand city. But it's the same city that God is going to use.
Yes.
God have a habit of using things that's not grand.
Come on, bitch.
Yes,
he does.
Yes.
If you go away, you go back to Jesus' birth, it wasn't grand.
Amen.
It was a grand celebration, but it wasn't grand because he was in a manger.
Amen.
He was around stinky animals.
That's right.
In a stinky feeding pen, trough. Somebody help me here. And I told him this morning, it had stinky people coming to see him.
Come on.
That's right.
Shepherds step in stuff, clean stuff. Somebody help me here.
Come on.
They don't take that. Where are they going to wash up at?
Right.
Shepherds came, nasty people came to see him. Lonely people came to see him. Bethlehem was a lonely place.
Amen.
He wasn't born in Jerusalem. Now, you go back and read the text earlier, you find out that Jesus was in Jerusalem. I mean, that Joseph and his mother was in Jerusalem. They left Jerusalem to go to Bethlehem because the king had decreed that their taxes had to be paid.
That's right.
And you had to go back to your hometown.
That's right.
And Bethlehem was a city of David. David decided that this is where I'm going to lodge, and this is my city. And so Joseph, being of the lineage of David, had to go back to his hometown. I wish I had somebody here to know what I'm talking about. So Jesus was connected to David, or the divinity lineage, through Joseph, through David. That's why he had to go back to his hometown, Bethlehem. I wish I had somebody here. Read.
Yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me.
Listen, out of Bethlehem. He gonna come forth unto me. Read.
That is to be ruler in Israel.
He gonna be ruler in Israel. That's it. Come on.
Whose goings forth have been from of old.
Yes.
From everlasting.
Well, his rulership has to run from everlasting. In order for him to rule, he had to be a king. In order to be a king, you got to be connected to the kingly lineage. To be a king over Israel, you do. And so we find out that there was some connection. Listen, 700 years when Micah was writing and saying that in Bethlehem, he going to come forth. He going to come out of Bethlehem. Listen, and the king is going to come out. He didn't say that the king is going to come out, but the ruler is going to come out. The ruler of Israel. And he's going to rule forever and ever. King to be able to come out of you. Jesus is that everlasting king. When everybody Somebody here say something to me. Micah shows up. When you go home, read Micah. Read, that's a good book. Luke picks it up. In the New Testament, second chapter of the book of Luke. I'm almost finished.
Luke the second chapter, first verse. And it came to pass in those days.
Yes.
That there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus. That all the world shall be taxed.
And they say registered. Okay. Had you not know that the IRS got it down that everybody's gonna be taxed?
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
You not know they got it down to a science now?
Come on.
That you can double if you want to. They coming at you.
Yes, sir.
I'm gonna help me here. The reason I said they coming at you, because I'm paying mine.
That's right.
And when they come at you, they not fair.
That's right.
They hurt you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So it's easier to get out of the way of hurt by just paying
them. Yeah.
I gotta be strict about my tax. I don't pay my tax. I might be strict about something, but not my tax. Because they know where you are.
Yes, sir.
You get child support, they take your taxes. You know what I'm saying? Stop you from driving.
Yes, sir.
We are the Joseph. I ain't had nothing to do with it. That's what Joseph said. Joseph paid his taxes. Let's know that Joseph was a just man. Joseph was not just a scoundrel that was denying a child that belonged to him.
Wow.
I'm talking to the men today.
Preach.
Men, we ought to stand up and be men.
Yes, it is.
We ought to stand up and be men.
It is.
Do the things that we're supposed to do as men.
That's right.
We have to do what we have to do. We got to do what we got to do. We got to count counsel.
Man.
Pick up bottles. Amen. Somebody help me here. You have to. Amen. Legally. Come on, read.
Verse 2.
And
this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria.
Syria, excuse me. Syria is a problem over in the Middle East of Syria right now.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Right now, there's a problem with Syria right now. Yeah. And you have to be swift enough to understand that something is going on. Something serious is going on. I scratched my head. I said, how in the world can somebody hack into Sony?
Right.
Now, I know you can bootleg and get the movie before time.
Right.
But this ain't what I'm talking about. Somebody would have way surpassed that.
Mm-hmm.
Way past that.
Way past.
I mean, you know, the movie's not like you can bootleg it, you can get it. I'm just saying, I don't do no bootlegging, hey? Don't look at me in that tone. That I see your face, let me look over this way. And my wife got it, so we don't even watch bootleg movies in our house.
That's right.
We don't. It's a good movie. It's on. I ain't seen it. And I go to Bob's shop and my nephew give me one of them bootleg. She won't even let me watch it at the house. That's a good plug when you throw your bootleg away. Come on. But there's something going on in Syria right now. Come on, B.
Verse 3. All went to be taxed.
All went to register.
Everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee.
Yes.
Out of the city of Nazareth. Into Judea.
Yes.
Into the city of David. Which is called Bethlehem.
Because
he was of the house and lineage of David.
Now, it's important for that little piece that you read right there, that Lady Fritz read. It's important for you to understand. Because in order for Jesus to be the king of Israel, he had to be connected to David. Now, they gave Jesus a whole lot of names because they said he didn't have a father. And Joseph made it clear that he didn't have anything to do with it.
Wow.
But Joseph stepped up to the plate and became Jesus' earthly father. You got some men that's got to sit, that step up to the plate and become the father of children that they didn't bear.
Amen.
Amen. I'm talking right now.
Amen.
Somebody help me in this place. Amen. There's nothing wrong with stepping up to the plate and taking on responsibility.
That's right.
That's what a real man will do.
That's right.
I'm talking. Real men step up. Wimps hide and run.
Come on.
But Job decided, yeah, I said that Indians get bigger. What do you mean, Mr. Ray? That ain't my baby. I ain't your girlfriend. Come on, you hired it. You hired it. Well, listen. Just think about it. All of a sudden, you know, you home. You come home from work, and your wife tells you, or your spouse, fiance, help me, tell you, hey honey, I'm pregnant. Okay, hold on. Husband and wife, right? Husband and wife, real husband and wife. They've been married for some time. Wife come home and tell you, hey, I'm pregnant. You come home and your wife say, I'm pregnant. And it's of the Holy Ghost. what do you say?
And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered.
She's getting ready to give child, come birth, yeah.
And she brought forth the firstborn son. And wrapped him in his father's clothes.
Yes.
And laid him in a manger. Because there was no room for them in the inn.
It was amazing how our superintendent took us this morning into dramatization and had us dramatically work this skit out. And it was amazing, and he had Lady Frazier and I playing the part of Joseph and Mary, and I was glad because after a while Joseph didn't have anything else to say, and I like playing a part I don't have nothing to say just being there, but we had a little, I don't know what it was, a pendulum, I don't know what that thing was. Wrapped up in a rag and put it in a little basket and set it on the shelf. And it was our baby. Well, it was her baby. Because I had nothing to do with it. Hello, somebody. and I'm saying, how can this thing be? See, you know, I'm thinking, this baby is laying here. Everybody coming and celebrating. And sometimes when it comes to the birth of Jesus, we just can't imagine what he went through. Just being ridiculed, talked about. What people in the community said about him and about his mother and about his father. How they probably deemed them as liars, and they did something behind closed doors that they ought to be ashamed about. You can't imagine what Jesus went through in his birth. When it comes to celebrating him, we need to celebrate our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When it comes to Christmas, we should do all the things that we're going to do, but we should never forget about Jesus. Amen. Jesus is the reason for the season.
Right.
He is the reason for this season, this event, Jesus' birth. Amen. This event, it took 700 years. I just gave you these two prophecies and this answer, the fulfillment of the prophecy. These prophecies, you go home, you read those chapters, read those scriptures, you will see that these prophecies that took place, amen, it makes you a little more, it can help you to get a little more comfortable to believe in the Bible. Yes. That the Bible is true. Or when you read, see what Isaiah said it, and you check and get a timeline chart, and you go back and you trace the 714 on a timeline chart to where Matthew's is, you will see that somewhere around 700 years. You go back and you read Micah, the fifth chapter, and you take it into Luke, you will see it's almost 700 years. Amen. The birth of Jesus. Amen. It is important for us to understand that we need to always glorify him during our Christmas season.
Amen.
This day, amen, it belongs to Jesus. Amen. He is the reason for the season. Somebody may be in here and may not be.
Withholding nothing, I surrender all to you. Everything I give to you. Withholding nothing. Withholding.